I'm delighted to join all of you in honoring a remarkable attorney and an outstanding member of our American community, my friend Bill McBride. The name Chesterfield Smith has come to be synonymous with service because throughout his career, Chesterfield Smith stood for equal justice, preached the nobility of the law, and reminded us that no man is above it. That philosophy has been a hallmark of Holland Knight, whose public service mission has grown along with the firm itself. That's why it is such an honor to receive the Chesterfield Smith Award, and I can think of no one more deserving to receive it than Bill McBride. Bill, through your service to our nation and the armed forces, your leadership of the American Bar Association, and your guidance of a firm that exemplifies the best of American law, you have shown us the very ideal of American citizenship. Congratulations on this richly deserved honor, and I know you will continue to serve and inspire for many years to come.
The Holland and Knight name carries with it a steadfast legacy, a legacy built upon honor, integrity, and service above self. For the past decade, this legacy has been enhanced by a man who exemplifies the true spirit of the firm in every way. The recipient of the 1999 Chesterfield Smith Lawyer Award, Bill McBride. It's no accident that Bill McBride became sole managing partner of Holland & Knight, for it seems that throughout his entire life, in whatever was undertaken by this man of character, conviction, and compassion, his destiny has been to lead.
I've never really tried to be an overachiever. That's a relative term. I have sensed, however, that more often than not, I will try a little bit harder, meaning at every stage of my life, I sort of naturally want to do my best.
He has had character ever since I can remember, even as a child. From the time that his Little League, he was on a Little League team and they counted on him and he had his hands all stitched up from an accident. And it was an all-star game, and by all, he should not have even been playing. He just went in there, hit the home run, and ran around the bases because his team needed him.
Bill McBride has never been one to sit on the sidelines of life. And even if he shuns the term overachiever, his list of accomplishments would suggest just that. Even during high school in Leesburg, Florida, Bill was president of his senior class, governor of Florida Boys State, lieutenant governor of Florida Key Clubs, and just to prove he was neither bookworm nor angel, he was even voted Leesburg lover.
People would look at Bill McBride back in high school and say, there's a comer. He was an accomplished athlete. He was a good student. He was a leader of young men and women. Those folks who knew him back then said, here's a fella that's going to accomplish something. And he has certainly proven that to be true.
Bill's exceptional talents as an athlete won him a full scholarship to play football at the University of Florida. But his promising athletic pursuits were cut short in his freshman year when he suffered a serious knee injury.
On Thanksgiving, he was at home and we were all there, and Bill says, oh, by the way, I don't have my scholarship anymore. And mother said, well, you know, she just went ballistic. What are you talking about? And he said, it's not fair that I take a scholarship when I can't play. And she says, well, how are you going to afford to go to college? And he had already lined up two or three jobs and gave the scholarship back because he had too much pride to go and be one of the guys that just sits on the sidelines. And he also didn't think it was fair for someone else who could go to college on a football scholarship.
Upon completion of his undergraduate studies, Bill was ready to pursue his lifelong ambition. So in 1967, he entered the University of Florida Law School. But this pursuit was soon to find a fork in the road.
Time to take a phase train. Lonely days are gone, I'm going home. My baby just wrote me a
summer after my first year in law school, I'd done really well in law school. I was top of my class, but I was conflicted. I really had a lot of questions about my sense of honor and duty. Ernest Hemingway said, "A man's not a man until he knows how he can face his own death." I was and probably still am rather romantic about those sort of things. I wanted to see exactly what type of person I was. And I made a decision that in the end, that my role at that age was not a leadership role. My job was to fulfill what I thought was my responsibility to my country.
Here's my brother telling me that he has made this huge decision when he didn't have to go to Vietnam, and me being a younger sister, I said, "But why? Well, you don't have to go," because he had a bad knee from football. And he told him he couldn't live with himself if he knew that he sort of cheated his way out. And that was someone who was in his early 20s. And you talk about character. It was just phenomenal that he could think that deeply when everybody else was thinking it strictly for themselves.
So in 1968, Bill McBride became a Marine. Here too, Bill rose to the top. An honor graduate of Marine Corps Basic School, Bill went on to attend Army Ranger School, the toughest course available to him. He became one of the few Marines ever to graduate number one in the class. Upon completion, Bill was determined to make it into the field, even though at this point there was a ceiling on troops. His determination won out, and Bill saw combat.
My combat experience taught me a lot about personal discipline and the value of effort and character. I made mistakes that caused people to lose limbs, to die, that with a bright line could be drawn back, and to have to be able to search your own heart and understand that the consequence is not necessarily how you should be judged. It's the motivations and whether you did the best you could.
People like myself and all the other second lieutenants at the time, we recognized in Bill that he was truly a superb leader. That was borne out in his terrific combat record, leading Marines in combat, in battle, in very difficult situations. And you knew that he knew what he was doing, that he was going to lead you in the right direction, and that you were going to accomplish the mission.
After 3 years in the Marine Corps, numerous awards and citations, and a lifetime of experiences, Bill returned to law school. But it didn't take long for another opportunity to disrupt his studies. While many of Bill's contemporaries were eager to complete law school and begin reaping the financial benefits of their careers, Bill was more concerned about reaping the benefits of life experience.
I actually interrupted my law school studies 3 times, once for the Marine Corps, once for the American Bar Association, and once to raise money for my college fraternity. And I think that I've been able to approach people a little less stereotypically than some of my contemporaries. Because I've been a waiter and a busboy, I've been with no money stranded at a bus station. I've been in a situation where I had to face my own death, and all those life experiences have helped me to, you know, to do my job better.
Before finally finishing law school, Bill was to have one more break, a break that would shape his entire future. That day in 1973, when Bill went to interview for a position assisting the incoming president of the American Bar Association, little did he know that one of his lasting legacies was being set into motion.
He attracted me most because I thought he wanted to do good, to help people, to make people's life better, to make our municipality and our county and our state university better.
In 1975, Bill joined the Holland Knight firm as an associate. Chesterfield Smith saw to it that Bill's experience was well-rounded and proceeded to send him to work with the firm's best and brightest attorneys throughout the state in various areas of law practice.
the thing with Chesterfield Smith was, you know, one of those opportunities no one will ever have, and I'm glad it changed my life. He taught me intellectual courage. He was always willing to say what he thought. Every issue he was willing to look at fresh, as if it was the first time it came onto his, into his mind. But there were many times when he took positions, which I know that most other men would not have taken. And it was a great lesson for me.
I welcome this kind of examination because people have got to know whether or not their president is a crook. Well, I'm not a crook.
Bill McBride was climbing the firm's ladder of success and at the same time enjoying the life of a bachelor. Right around his 39th birthday, he met Alex Sink, a very successful banker with Nations Bank, who was adeptly climbing her own ladder. Finally, Bill had met his match.
At last.
When I met Alex, I was really pretty lucky.
My love has come along.
In fact, some people were suggesting I'd better hurry because I wasn't getting any more attractive.
My lonely days are over.
Our first date, I was just very intrigued by his background. Not only been to Vietnam, but he was a Marine, which the Marines are very strong in my life. And he had just come back from working in New Hampshire for Reuben Askew's campaign. And I thought to myself, I'd never met a lot of successful lawyers who were Democrats, so I decided that might not be so bad.
She, as everybody knows, is a very unique person. She's been enormously successful in her business. One of the few women who really, really made a mark, I think, in the banking industry. She is very charitable. We both share a lot of the same passions for causes. We're both Democrats, and she's a great mom.
For you are mine at last.
Anyone who knows Bill well knows that of all the achievements in his life, the one that matters to him most is his family. Bill and Alex's children, William Albert and Cheryl Alexander, are first on the couple's long list of priorities. In 1992, that list of priorities became more complicated when Bill McBride was elected sole managing partner of Holland & Knight. To fully appreciate the significance of this achievement, you simply have to review an enlightening article written about the firm in 1988 during a turbulent period of management by committee. The article documented the changing dynamics of Holland & Knight upon Chesterfield Smith's relinquishment of the esteemed but onerous position of sole managing partner. The irony lies in the final sentence, where a member of the firm is quoted, "It would be doubtful if the partners would ever again elect just one person. There are no more Chesterfields." It may well be true, there are no more Chesterfields. But all would agree, Bill McBride has made an indelible mark on the Holland & Knight legacy.
I feel now and have felt all along that nobody could have done it better than Bill. And most everything he's done, I think he's done better than I would have done. And he has just been damn good at it.
Bill breaks a lot of rules. He makes up new rules. And he almost always makes up rules that other people tend to follow later. And in this case, he has proven that Holland & Knight can succeed enormously in attracting good people and in keeping good people and keeping them happy, while at the same time doing more and more to serve the community, everything from tutoring small children to setting up foundations to teach young children about the Holocaust. There's a myriad of examples.
I grew up in a very segregated environment in an old South where the sheriff of my county was a member of the Ku Klux Klan, so I've seen bad and I've seen evil. I really believe and am heavily involved in civil liberties issues, free speech, tolerance, non-discrimination type causes.
Bill McBride believes that you owe a responsibility back to your community. In my line of work as Attorney General, I deal with many lawyers and many law firms. Bill McBride and Holland & Knight, they're unique because most lawyers most law firms are takers. Holland Knight and Bill McBride are givers.
I think Bill would want to be remembered for having had a positive impact on the lives of a lot of people.
In fact, Bill's charity goes far beyond his professional life. Both he and Alex are known to be enormously giving of their time and wealth to help those less fortunate.
I've cared a lot about a lot of people that others would throw away and not give a second chance to. More often than not, we don't give people a fresh start, and the load gets heavier and heavier. All of us need a second chance.
He will give up of his time to be with his family, and he will care about people in need and provide money for scholarships, and has made Holland and Knight not only a successful enterprise, but also a very giving and caring one based on his leadership.
He's generous. He is willing to support people's efforts far beyond his own practice. And as a consequence, he's going to leave a tremendous legacy.
And that's what makes him such a great leader in a law practice. That's what made him such a great leader on the battlefield. That's what makes him such a great leader in terms of community service.
He does probably things that you and I will never know about as far as helping other people.
Another one of Bill McBride's crowning achievements for the firm has been its move toward expansion, nationally and internationally.
For 27 years, I ran the firm. When I started running the firm, it had 9 lawyers. Now it has near 900 lawyers.
Bill McBride was able to take a very good, large, Florida-based law firm, and in fact, about 7 years ago, the same size as the Attorney General's office, and he's able to develop it into an outstanding national law firm.
Tough, disciplined, focused. He has a real vision for in business that is pretty extraordinary.
He's always thinking about what the firm should look like next month, next year, or 5 years from now, and he keeps drawing that picture.
And I'm hopeful that through their offices in Israel and in Mexico, and I'm sure in other places, they will not just be exporting legal services, they'll be exporting a lot of the values that this country stands for and Holland and Knight stands for.
Bill McBride's tenure as managing partner will soon end. So it's not surprising that many have opinions regarding what lies ahead for this man in the prime of his professional life.
I see a very successful man already. So I think he's the one who has to decide, is there something different than that in his future? And I would say that if he decides to do something different, he will be quite successful.
I'm term limited out, and in 3 years, the Office of Attorney General is open. I'd be proud to have Bill McBride running for Attorney General of the state of Florida.
I think the sky is the limit for Bill. Whatever Bill McBride sets his mind to in the future, he will accomplish.
And would be a terrific political leader in our nation. He could count on me as one of his most enthusiastic supporters and backers, and I can guarantee him 20,500 votes from the Marines and Sailors of the 4th Marine Division in 50 states across the nation. And to Bill McBride, Semper Fidelis, Captain McBride.
Honor, generosity, compassion, strength, leadership. It seems too good to be true that you could find all these traits in one person. But Bill McBride has demonstrated each one throughout his life in everything he does. From the way he coaches Little League to the way he's helping Holland and Knight become one of the most respected law firms in this country and beyond.
Holland and Knight has a destiny, and our destiny is to be one of the really fine significant legal organizations in the world, a force for good, which isn't measured by money, and it isn't measured necessarily by size or client base. It's how much we can do for our families, for the people in the firm, and for the communities they're in.
The recipient of the 1999 Chesterfield Smith Lawyer Award, Bill McBride.